Joe, are we ready? Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, everyone. Find your seats, please. Well, we've reached our final speaker of the afternoon, and it is my pleasure to introduce Manoj Narang. When doing the research for this one, I found out that we overlapped at MIT for 2 years. So if our last two speakers on the stage were for Harvard, we have two now who are from MIT, and so, you know, there's a little bit more balance in the world. He worked at Goldman Sachs doing fixed income arbitrage. He was, for 15 years, he was the CEO and also the founder of Tradeworx, and he is now the CEO of Mana Partners LLC. Please give him a warm welcome.
Thank you. Hi. Thanks to Quantopian for the speaking invitation. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yes.
Okay. So, I'm really loud. So when I was asked to pick a topic for my discussion, I decided on a somewhat ironic term called untapped alpha. And the reason is that after a day of listening to detailed presentations on esoteric topics, esoteric and abstruse topics, I felt that it would be a good idea to leave the assembled folks with, some unconventional or slightly out-of-the-box thoughts about the topics that we're discussing today, just to put a unique perspective on it, because I strongly believe that that's ultimately where alpha comes from, is from thinking outside the box. And so that combined with the fact that I really, when I was asked to deliver the closing keynote, had no idea what I would talk about and wanted to pick a name for my talk that was sufficiently vague that it could subsume anything I came up with at the last second. So, but it turns out that I think Untapped Alpha is a perfectly good topic to discuss in terms of the origin story of where alpha comes from. You know, whether you are interested in how to position yourself to make money in the future based on where the market's going, or whether you're an allocator rather than a manager, whether you are a policy maker or a regulator, I think your understanding of whatever interests you depends very heavily on knowing how we got here in the first place, where alpha comes from. Only then can you begin to appreciate and understand where the market is going as far as the evolution of alpha. So that's what I plan to discuss today, is where does alpha come from, and then where is it going? So I think a lot of people are under the misapprehension, and I primarily fault business schools for this, that alpha in the quantitative realm comes from market inefficiency. Okay, meaning that there's something wrong with the market or something inefficient about people's behavior, and the act of quantitative trading or running arbitrage strategies is somehow rectifying that or extracting rents based on inefficient behavior of other market participants. And I disagree pretty strongly with that. That is not to say that inefficiency can't cause arbitrage opportunities, very clearly it can. But I think that really gives short shrift to what the role of quantitative trading is in the marketplace today. So one of the problems I have with market inefficiency being the driver of market alpha is that it suggests that as the market gets more and more inefficient, more and more efficient over time as the effect of arbitrage manifests itself, that alpha will go away. And quantitative trading, therefore, is a shrinking or finite space. But that's in stark contrast to everything that we've seen over the past few decades, where allocations to quant strategies keep going higher and higher. The opportunity space seems to be growing and growing. So I think that in and of itself puts the lie empirically to this notion that quantitative alpha comes from market inefficiency. For one thing, even if inefficient behavior or inefficient regulations are arbed out, whatever that means, you can always expect more inefficient behavior or more inefficient regulations to arise to take their place. And you know, the story of the market has seen that pattern play out time and again. You know, for example, I don't mean to suggest that all regulation or anything, you know, related to market policy is inefficient. So, for example, regulators made a concrete decision to have fragmented markets. Okay, they decided that it would be to the benefit of long-term investors if there were competition in trading venues and that costs would be lowered. And regulators have largely gotten what they wanted. We have fragmented markets now. We have intense competition between exchanges in a lot of different asset classes, foremost among them being U.S. equities, but you know, most asset classes, actually. But as a result of that fragmentation, they created an opportunity for a new breed of quantitative traders, which are known as high-frequency traders. High-frequency traders are the glue that holds together fragmented markets. I submit to you that quant traders, more generally, are the glue that holds together markets in general, and that without quantitative traders, you can't really have properly functioning markets. Let's just stick with the topic of inefficiency for a second. I think certainly you see that there are a lot of inefficient regulations, a lot of inefficient policies that create arbitrage opportunities. I would say that these are not positives for the market. They're not positives for the trading community, and they don't accurately reflect what the social role of quant trading is. An example would be, asymmetric tax policy. Anywhere where you see internal inconsistency in social policy or economic policy, you have a chance for there to be some opportunity in the financial markets to take advantage of that. So in the futures market, for example, you have a situation where futures are taxed asymmetrically relative to equities. So for example, if you wanted to buy the stock market, the S&P 500, and you were choosing, you know, whether to do that through ETFs in the cash equity markets or futures, such as E-mini S&P 500 futures, you would be at a disadvantage if you chose equities from a tax perspective. And as a result of that, you have arbitrage opportunities. You have a situation where a very significant amount of price discovery that happens in the US equity market occurs in the futures markets rather than the cash equity markets. And that now necessitates the need for information to flow between those two market centers, which have great geographic distance between them as we speak today, which then creates an inefficiency in the market, okay, that a certain niche of market participants are able to arbitrage. So that's not going to end. We have all kinds of inefficient things on the horizon. As I speak, the application for a new exchange called IEX is about to be approved, by all accounts. It hasn't been approved yet, but by all accounts. And it's the SEC's determination on whether to approve this application comes down to whether 1 millisecond of latency is de minimis and is effectively nothing. The reason why this is important is because the rules of the market that they previously architected, regulation NMS, stipulates that you cannot introduce any delays into the display of quotations. So the question is 1 millisecond a delay? And that's what the application for this new exchange, or its approval, I should say, boils down to. So this would be a catastrophic inefficiency, in my opinion. It's likely going to get approved, but it's going to result in greater opportunities for quant traders, because what it does is it ambiguates the the national best bidder offer. It introduces a variable amount of latency into quotes, and not all market participants are equally equipped to handle that ambiguity. And you know, that's a lot of the same ambiguity that exists in the first place that gives a certain segment of the market what many believe to be a unfair advantage as things stand now. And we're only going to exacerbate that problem by impeding price discovery, by introducing noise into the process, by having arbitrary delays, however small. So another example, you're about to have a provision of the Jobs Act go into effect that requires a certain segment of securities to trade in nickel spreads instead of penny spreads. That's going to require an awful lot of people to rewrite their order routing logic and their order handling logic. It's a form of inefficiency in the market that a certain segment of the population, the trading community, myself included, I hope, will seek to benefit from. So let's not discount the role of inefficiency in the market when it comes to generating alpha. But to me, I think that, like I said, that gives short shrift to what quantitative trading is about. Really, as I alluded to earlier, I believe that quantitative trading is the glue that holds the market together. And, you know, to discuss that notion properly, I think we have to back up a little bit and talk about what a market actually is. A market is a mechanism for setting prices so that supply equals demand. It doesn't matter if you're talking about a commodities market, or if you're talking about a wholesaling market, or whether you're talking about a securities market, it's the same thing either way. You want to bring together buyers and sellers, and you want to do so in a way where supply equals demand, and so you need a price-setting mechanism that allows supply to equal demand. So that's the hallmark of a properly functioning market. So who are the kinds of people that want to interact in this market? Who are these buyers and sellers? Well, they have many motivations, the principal ones being investment, people who want to speculate on certain opinions that they have, or forecasts, or beliefs, or secular trends that they would like to exploit, or what have you. That's one camp, investors and speculators. I personally view them to be exactly the same thing, but some people would differ. Another group of people is risk managers or hedgers. People, for example, at corporations who have certain risks that could be hedged in the financial markets will seek to access the markets to do that. Airline companies, transportation companies, whatever. Lots of companies have hedgeable risks that they access the markets for. The need for liquidity is another motivation to access the markets. Whether you're looking to deploy capital or looking to redeem capital. You have a demand for liquidity, and you want to access that liquidity in the markets. So a properly functioning market should be able to serve that need very, very effectively. So the question is, if you group all of these participants in the market together, is their collective participation in the market sufficient to serve the need that I expressed earlier, which is to set prices so that supply equals demand? And I would argue that it is most definitely not sufficient. In particular, the activity of these kinds of investors will, combinatorially speaking, provide some amount of liquidity, because sometimes people will be in the market to buy at the same time that other people are in the market to sell the same securities. And even less often, those transactions will occur at the same price, those desires to buy or sell will occur at the same price, leading to a transaction. But that's relatively rare. More often than not, people will have similar views on secular trends, and therefore similar investment theses, and they want to be on the same side of the market, whether it's buy or sell. And same thing with hedging and risk management. You'll find that the needs of longer-term investors or corporate managers or what have you tend to overlap quite a bit, and therefore be expressed in the same direction. But there's no doubt that these natural players, as it were, can find some liquidity in the market by interacting with each other. That's definitely true. The question is, do they find sufficient liquidity for the market to efficiently function as a clearinghouse of supply and demand? And the answer is no. It's very easily seen that the answer is no by virtue of the fact that all three of those kinds of participants in the market have one thing in common, which is that they have the desire to transact specific securities. Okay? So whether you are a speculator that believes that cloud computing is going to take over the universe and therefore you want to buy shares in Google and Amazon and other cloud computing companies, or whether you are a risk manager that really needs to buy crude oil futures to hedge some sort of risk that you have in your company's operations, you're going to access the market with a very specific security or a set of securities in mind that satisfy your objectives. And that truly is what differentiates quantitative trading from other kinds of natural participation in the market, and what allows quantitative trading to be the glue that holds the market together. Because we live in a world where, although people have a natural preference for individual securities, the securities themselves are inextricably correlated with each other. Every pair of securities, of which there are hundreds of thousands in the markets, every pair of them is correlated to each other due to a variety of different factors, some of which are structural and some of which are just based on overlapping dependence on a small set of macroeconomic drivers. Whatever the reasons, it is a fact, a well-known, well-established, non-controversial fact that securities markets and securities themselves are correlated to each other. And so when you live in a world where market participants have strong preferences or axes, as I'll refer to them going forward, when they have axes that reflect specific securities, but the securities themselves are correlated, that naturally creates the ability for non-security-seeking participants to come into the marketplace and create additional liquidity by accessing liquidity where it is not in demand, where there's an oversupply of it, and transferring that liquidity to securities where there is demand for it. And in a nutshell, I think that that more or less fully encapsulates what quantitative trading is all about. And there are a variety of different ways to do that, and they lead to a variety of different styles in a variety of different asset classes that involve a variety of different kinds of data and a variety of different kinds of techniques, but it's all really the same damn thing. What it boils down to is that there's not enough natural liquidity from the participants of the canonical players in the market. They need more liquidity than what their own natural participation yields. And so there is a cottage industry, not so small anymore, of market participants that can marshal liquidity in areas where investors are not demanding it and transfer it to securities where they are demanding it. And what's important about that is that it's crucial to the price setting function that I alluded to earlier, okay? Because that price setting function does not occur in a vacuum. You cannot efficiently set the price of Oracle in the market without also efficiently setting the price of every other security. For example, Oracle is a member of countless indexes, so all the indexes that Oracle is in have to have their prices reset anytime the price of Oracle is set. Oracle is in the same industry as Microsoft and other companies. So if there is new information in the marketplace that results in a repricing of Oracle, that same information presumably would have some impact on all the other securities in the industry as well. So what I'm trying to say is that the action of quantitative trading, the impact of quantitative trading on the market, is basically one where liquidity is transferred in one direction and price impact is propagated in the reverse direction. Okay? So when there are more buyers than sellers in a particular security and price impact is exerted on the security, it is mitigated through the action of quantitative trading by being transferred to the entire cross-section, the entire continuum of the securities markets at a variety of different timescales. The byproduct, the natural byproduct of that transference is that liquidity flows in the opposite direction. Okay? So to me, that's what quantitative trading is all about. And that's why it's very, very easy to see that so long as there are natural participants in the markets who have a demand for liquidity, that there will always be room for quantitative trading. Quantitative trading is not going anywhere. It's not going to be arbed out. It's not ever going to be the case that inefficiencies are going to go away and therefore there are no opportunities. Quite the contrary, that's not where the preponderance of opportunities come from in the first place. They come from dislocations to the cross-sectional equilibrium prices of stocks through the activity of liquidity-seeking investors. And so as long as you have investors and markets, you will have the need for a glue to hold these markets together. And that's what quantitative trading, to me, is all about. So, to me, has pretty significant consequences for all kinds of things that interest people, such as what's the social role of quantitative trading, such as what are optimal policies for market structure. But I think for this particular crowd, I think the more interesting thing to discuss would be where do we go from here? So I recently started a new firm, Mana Partners, which is a quantitative trading firm and financial technology firm. And so obviously what I'm about to tell you reflects my own beliefs and my company's beliefs as a spokesman for my company, and you know how, to some extent, how I'm positioning my company based on where I see the market developing and where opportunity lies in the future. So I think that if you understand properly where quantitative trading comes from and you know where the opportunities come from, which is basically that quants are looking to create synthetic replicates of securities that investors are trying to buy and sell by looking at linear combinations of correlated securities. If you understand all that and understand that that's not really going to change, I think that you can see where some of the opportunities can come in. So there, the point is that there's a couple of different ways that that process plays out. So one way is, and those ways have to do with, how information propagates into the market. One method is symmetric information propagation or symmetric information discovery. So this is where everybody has access to the same information. Okay. So in the case where investors have access to information at the same time, so for example, through the release of data items that are covered by Reg FD, Regulation Fair Disclosure, the market's price setting mechanism, the notion of setting prices to a level that's fair where supply is going to be equal to demand, that again is largely a function that's carried out by quants. I myself for 13 years at my previous firm ran a strategy which I referred to as information arbitrage that looked at all of the kinds of data items that are covered by Reg FD and attempted to statistically measure what their immediate impact on the market would be and then to participate in the market's pricing in mechanism based on that. And there are tons of people doing that in increasingly sophisticated ways these days. And there, really, the alpha of the future is going to come from better and more sophisticated techniques for analyzing that data. As we go forward, we're going to have bigger and bigger databases of accumulated information, more and more accurately timestamped, so you can properly attribute the arrival or the movement of securities to the arrival of new information. As little as 10 or 15 years ago, that didn't exist. So now you have very rich, reliable data sets that can be studied, and you have advancements in techniques like machine learning that have been the topic of a lot of today's discussions that can be used to model nonlinear behaviors, you know, of securities prices, you know, in terms of their dependencies on these data items. So I think that's a very exciting area for growth in the future. But another very exciting area for growth in the future when it comes to the pricing in of, you know, symmetric information is data sources that are non-traditional, that are not covered by Reg FD. So, you know, we have a gigantic proliferation of data sources nowadays that come from e-commerce activity, that come from various, you know, governmental and non-governmental sources, whether they're agencies or trade organizations or what have you. They're just, you know, a lot of niche and not so niche data sources that are not protected by Reg FD, meaning that there's no requirement for people to find out about these kinds of information on a level playing field basis. And that's where I see, you know, a lot of the focus of quant shifting to in the coming years in terms of, I still call it, you know, symmetrically available information, because generally, if you pay enough, you can access the data, or if you're diligent enough about looking for the data, you know, a lot of this data is not even advertised that it exists, and it's just sitting on government websites and stuff like that. But if you're diligent about locating these things, you know, the information is available symmetrically for the most part. So I think that's where a lot of opportunity is going to come from in the future. But another way that information propagates into the market is asymmetrically. And that's where certain actors in the market have privileged information. I don't want to say inside information, although that's certainly a part of it. But information that is not easily obtainable by the preponderance of market participants. And there, the role of quantitative traders is still very large. There, prices don't instantly reset to their fair values. They happen incrementally through the provision of liquidity. There, what happens is that you know, price discovery plays out through the actions of the party that has the asymmetric information advantage, who then goes to access liquidity in the markets with a profit motive in mind, presumably. And quantitative traders are generally on the opposite side of that. Market makers most immediately, but quantitative traders, when spreads between securities start to go out of whack. And, you know, even though that information is asymmetric and possibly pertinent to just one security or one industry or one, you know, a small group of securities, it still needs to propagate to some extent to the broader cross-section of the market. And quantitative traders serve a very important role there. So even in that function, I see a lot of exciting developments for quantitative traders, and some in particular that I am interested in and positioning my company to benefit from are cross-asset class sorts of opportunities where, you know, you're looking outside the market that's experiencing, you know, the liquidity events to create replicating portfolios or to create hedges or what have you. So for example, equities and equity options, right? So if you have a information event in equities leading to, you know, the rise in a price of a certain security, if you're a market maker or a quantitative trader in that security, let's say it's XYZ, you can synthetically create XYZ in the options market, right? You can go long a call and short a put or what have you. The point is that options are correlated with their underlying securities. And so there's the possibility of transferring liquidity from one market to the other, you know, which is very, very commonplace within the US equity market, and it's very, very commonplace within the equity options market. But there's not quite as much of that happening as you would think between those two markets. So that's a very, very exciting opportunity to me. And I think that you'll see more and more people going across asset classes, you know, to look for interesting trading opportunities. So, you know, as I said, one of the most important things you can do if you want to think about what the future holds for quantitative trading or any other kinds of trading for that matter, where alpha generation is concerned, is to understand what markets are for, who the market participants are, what their roles are in the market. And you know, it's really good to have a internally consistent worldview about those things to put yourself on a sound intellectual footing when you're thinking about these things. That said, I think that it's also very, very important to think out of the box. I think in the end, alpha can come about in one of two ways. It can come about through incremental improvements to the status quo, or it can come from completely novel approaches where people are willing to think outside the box, explore new business models, reinvent the wheel, if necessary, a slightly different way. I think that what I'm referring to there is more colloquially known as creativity. I think in the end, one of the things that conferences like this can do is they can teach you what the state of the art is. But my feeling has always been that the best way to extract value out of these kinds of forums is to use them to spark new ideas for yourself. I mean, the people who are best positioned to make incremental improvements on the state of the art are the giant established players who already have barriers to entry, who already have the state of the art. And so people who are new to the space, looking to build new things and get a toehold in this very hyper-competitive space, I would say that on balance, understanding and mastering how people currently do things is not the right recipe for making your mark. I think that what you have to do instead is use opportunities like this to catalyze new ideas that are unique and original to yourself, new ways of doing things. Often that involves business process innovations more than anything else. So my hope is that some of you who are interested in starting new businesses or growing your existing business in this area will think of these presentations that you heard today with that frame of mind. So that concludes my discussion. I'll be happy to entertain any questions if anybody has any. Thanks.
This question is with respect to liquidity, volatility, and the new regulations. Do you believe the regulators' arguments that with banks holding more capital, they'll be less levered and there'll be less running to the exits during bad times? Do you believe that argument, or do you think that the less liquidity will result in more volatility?
Yeah, I think liquidity and volatility are close cousins of each other. To me, volatility basically is indicative of an imbalance between the supply and demand for liquidity. I think when there's excessive demand for liquidity relative to how much supply of liquidity there is, that manifests itself as volatility. I'm generally not in favor of policy actions that reduce liquidity, such as widening of spreads or creating ambiguity about prices and impeding price discovery or creating trading frictions in general. So I'm not sure if that answered your question. I actually will confess to missing the first part of your question. I couldn't hear you. But
right.
Was there any specific regulation that you had in mind that you wanted me to address? Or?
Well, just that they're asking banks to hold so much more capital.
And asking banks to hold more capital.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that actually gets to more of a different question as to whether banks should be involved in this sort of activity in the first place, or whether it's better left to institutions that aren't playing with customer money. I think it's more about that than about market efficiency. I don't think that the market's any less efficient if banks are not allowed to risk their customers' deposits on speculative bets. I think, you know, on balance, I'm a proponent of that sort of segregation. But you know, that's above my pay grade, so I don't really have a strong opinion on it either way.
So in the roughly two roles that the quant trader plays that you mentioned with the symmetric information and asymmetric information, it seems like in the asymmetric case, the quant trader is actually losing, right? He's on the wrong side of that trade because he doesn't have the information. He's still doing his job and it helps disseminate that information throughout the market, but he's losing. So there's probably some kind of, or my intuition would be there's some kind of intuition there between the money he makes in the symmetric case and the money he loses in the asymmetric case, and maybe that's your alpha as a quantitative trader. So my question is, do you think that that role could be commoditized? Like, yes, you will get paid for providing that service to the market, but there's some price that the market will pay for that service, and as it gets more crowded and more competitive, those spreads will get thinner.
So it's a really good question. And of course, the real market is far, far more complex than the idealized picture that I painted for you up here today. So yes, it's quite often the case that when a market participant is in possession of asymmetric information, that their activity will cause market makers to lose money. So I wasn't referring to market makers in particular, though. I was referring more to statistical arbitrageurs who are providers of a very important kind of liquidity in their own right. And there, you know, they're not tending to get run over because the running over, as it were, is occurring in the early stages of the price movement. And market makers are the principal, sufferers of that. But as spreads start to widen between the securities that are receiving the price impact and securities that haven't, there become cross-sectional opportunities for statistical arbitrageurs to then come in and provide liquidity and scoop up hedges as their liquidity is consumed. So generally speaking, even though they'll be losing money on the security where liquidity is being demanded, the hope and expectation is that they're making more by anticipating the movements of the correlated securities that haven't moved yet. So that cross-sectional activity is a profit center. And the hope and expectation of the quant trader is that profit exceeds the losses due to the information disadvantage. So you don't need there to be an explicit compensation for market making or liquidity provision. The fact that the market is naturally segmented in this way, where you have, the vast majority of the capital in the market, seeking individual securities in a world where securities are interlinked with each other and correlated to each other, that is really the setup that creates these profit making opportunities. I don't think you need to encode any sort of specific, explicit profit for market makers to render the service. I think it happens naturally, and I think that policy should facilitate that. I think that things like transaction taxes are antithetical to the proper functioning of the markets because they impede that function. So transaction taxes wouldn't really hurt liquidity seekers, at least in their first order activity. But it would hurt them in the sense that the people who actually have to do all this hedging and risk transfer and liquidity transfer, that involves a lot of transactions. And a transaction tax would put them out of business and significantly reduce the amount of liquidity they could provide, which would then impact the broader market. So I don't know. Did that answer your question?
Other questions? All right. Thank you very much, Manoj Narang.
Thanks.